Not live, but I guess we are live-ish.
Yeah. Cool. All right. Are you prepared?
Prepared?
Are you prepared? Are you ready?
Yeah. Let's have at it. Going on, everybody. Joey C in the place to be. I got a big boom box and a new CD coming at you live from the GFY studios with the AO show, authentic only. Here with my man Charlie in studio today. We got a next episode guest, Lisa, and today's guest, thanks for everybody for coming, Valarie Sakota. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
Right on. Cool. So, I guess Lisa and I were talking about this today, but I have standard questions. But the first one usually is, I don't want to summarize people. So if you can, please tell the people about you and who you are and what you do.
I am a creative and an entrepreneur. I'm co-founder of a botanical company called Barbari. And we make herbal smoking blends that are intended to be mixed with weed to sort of tailor your experience and your dose. And I'm a mom. Became a mom a year ago.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Or I guess a year and a half. Mm-hmm. Vancouver local. Born and raised in Oregon, though. Yeah.
Right on.
A bunch of other things.
I mean, it's a summary, but you can keep going.
I'm on the spot. And so, of course, it's all fleeting.
Yeah. I'm a human. I exist.
Yeah, exactly.
Congratulations. You made it. Right on. Good, good. I was thinking about this the other day, how we came to know each other. You guys were just customers. Not just customers, but patrons of the pizza shop, right?
Enthusiastic patrons.
Enthusiastic. Oh, thank you very much. I appreciate that. Yeah, you and Philip.
Yeah.
And you guys were just always super cool and whatnot. And I think I got introduced to Barbari. That's how you say it.
Mm-hmm.
Or some stickers up, tried some of the smokes and stuff like that, and then we had some conversations about it.
Yeah.
You know, you and Mac talked about potentially doing some stuff. Then we had a cool conversation down in here one time.
Yeah.
Before it was even podcast time, right?
Just the lady was on the wall.
Yeah, Space Babe was the only decoration at that time. We talked for a good hour or so.
Yeah.
It was a long time.
Yeah.
The topic of that conversation was you were thinking about doing a podcast too. What has become of that or not become of that, or what's the status with that?
I'm still stewing on it.
Nice.
I have been sort of planting some seeds. For context, I want to, and actually I haven't talked to her about this yet, mm-hmm. So I know she's going to hear about it as soon as she listens to this.
Nice.
But I want to interview my mom and sort of get an oral record of her life and, you know, just gain an understanding of who she was as a child, who she became as an adult, how that impacted the sort of evolution and trajectory of her mental health and addictions that she's experienced, and sort of how now who she is and what that kind of summary is. I was not raised by her, and so a lot of the kind of knowing of her on a deeper level is absent in a way that I think a lot of people have with their parents, you know, understanding them, hearing the stories of their childhood as they grow up and seeing them reflected in you as an adult and be like, oh, that's where I get that from.
Uh-huh.
You know, in my case, I get my adult things from my grandparents who raised me, and so I know a lot more about them than I do my mom. And we're sort of at a place in, I'm at a place in my life where I'm kind of bringing her closer in again now that I have a daughter and I'm sort of reflecting on motherhood in a different way. And I'm an adult and I don't feel as emotionally dependent on the success of that relationship that I, in the same way I did as like a child or a teenager. I feel like I'm in a place of curiosity and stability where I am ready to like talk shit out and just yeah, be kind of raw in this like conversational forum as opposed to I don't know. I can't think of. Yeah, I think that there's like a structure that comes with recording and an intention that comes with recording your voice that will benefit the types of conversations I want to have with her. And if that becomes a podcast where other people who aren't related to us and don't know us can benefit from that conversation, that's really cool. But that isn't really the focus for me right now. So I'm just, it's in progress. Like, I've been having conversations like this. It evolves a little bit every time I talk about it. And
with her, you've been having conversations like this?
No, with people like you, just like other people. I feel like, you know, when I'm ready, I'll bring it to her in a bit more of a formal way. And I want to be respectful of her story as well. And so, yeah, it's right now it's ideas on a Google Sheet. It's a little bit of like outline structure. It's been things I've been journaling about and just thinking through. And I guess I kind of view it as a artwork in a way. And I just want to respect the process a little bit. So I'm not trying to push it, but I'm working towards it one step at a time.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
That's, you know, not knowing the story, you know, just the time we, Valarie and I had talked about, you know, some things before, and you were pretty open about it, and that was courageous. And then even moving forward with this, taking the steps to get to that, it's, I would label that as courageous. It takes a lot of courage to get to that point, because it is the unknown, and finding out some stuff that is unknown can sometimes be painful or healing or all the things, but
yeah.
Alas, having the conversations, that was one of the main impetuses of the impetuses. No, well, what's it called? Is that the word I'm looking for?
Impetus.
See, I was around it. Shotgun approach in the I section. One of the impetuses of this was having a long format conversation for benefit of all, not even necessarily people having the conversation, but other people that could listen to it. I will apologize too. I'm not apologize. I'm making everybody aware that next door there is another birthday party, so there may be some cheering and hoopla and general merriment in here and over there too. So cool. Yeah, the podcast, it's become a pretty cool medium. Yeah,
it's super inspiring. I think I spend most of my time listening to podcasts these days, just
most of your time.
Yeah, totally, as I'm doing shit like folding laundry, painting the house, working sometimes. If I'm not doing like writing tasks, I'll just have podcasts or audiobooks running in the background. I feel like I've learned so much in the last however many 3 years, probably the pandemic era, where I've really been living in that mental space.
Which ones do you like to listen to? Podcasts?
Authentic Only Show is a recent favorite.
Nice.
Well, gosh, it runs the gamut. There's one called Terrible Thanks for Asking, and it's all about trauma and hard shit, and I love that one.
Who hosts that? Do you know?
Something McNamara.
Right on.
She started it after her husband died of cancer, and so it was all about her grieving process, but it's evolved in a pretty nice way over the, I don't know, I think almost 10 years that she's been doing it. I like the science nerdy podcast, Hidden Brain, Radiolab, love that shit. There's one called Outlaw Ocean that I recently just like absorbed in a day, pretty much. It's all about the lawlessness of the ocean, like different things that happen in the ocean, whether it's like modern day pirating or slavery or, you know, illegal fishing and the dumping of chemicals into the ocean, things that are so appalling that we think like, oh, that doesn't happen, or that happened 100 years ago, but it actually is happening in alarming, at an alarming scale now.
Outlaw ocean.
The outlaw ocean, it's really, really good.
Yeah, there's a lot of space out there to do some nefarious shit.
Yeah, and when you're in international waters, you know, almost anything goes.
Yeah,
and
no rules apply.
Yeah.
Kill all the fish, dump all the chemicals.
Yeah.
Pirate, your pirate people, things.
Right. Yeah.
Bananas. Right on. Cool. Now I have some new things to listen to.
Oh, yeah.
I find myself listening to the same handful of them, but I'm okay with that, I think, too, because I like the content.
Yeah.
Right on. So a general theme of pretty much everybody that's been on the show so far, the first one, when they're in the summary stage, artist or creative. You went with creative type up first. Do you not consider yourself an artist?
I do.
I mean, you came in covered in paint today, so.
Yeah. different kind of paint, I think.
Different medium.
I think that I infuse art making into a lot of what I do. Mm. Just the intention, I think, that goes into creating something and creating it with your own perspective. Mm. But in terms of like an art practice, the sort of formalism of art, and maybe even the pressure that comes along with it, I have learned is too stifling for me. So I aspire to be an artist. I think that that is a very romantic vision. But yeah, I create things that feel like art. I create shit. If it's like I create in my garden, I create in the kitchen, I create on, you know, with words and with in my business, and I think that it's hard to define, I think.
Yeah,
it's like hard to articulate what an artistic or creative practice means to me, but it's somewhere in there.
Agreed, yeah. In the last season, or last year, of the White Walls upstairs, one of the things I got written down, I don't know if it was me, I think it might have been me, but it just distilled down to me, it was like, not necessarily the meaning of life, but I think we're all just put here to create in some way, shape, or form. You know, add to the ocean of love, hopefully, you know, fill your bucket and then pour it into the ocean and repeat. Yeah, that's pretty cool. Creative artist type. Yeah, it's been the general theme. I mean, I would like to consider everybody artists. You know, the things you do, I've seen, you know, branding as it's called, and the things you do for the company and whatnot, I would consider that art. You know, you said earlier you're making a spreadsheet or a Google document.
Yeah.
That's, you know, and you put this intention into it. That's a real fine line not to call that art. You're creating something with intention, that's art, you know?
Yeah, totally. I agree with that. I mean, I look at you, I look at other people in the community who are creating things that aren't traditionally art, but like, I think that your food is artistic. I think it's very obvious that there's intention behind it and you're thoughtful about the ingredients and, you know, you have a perspective, you speak about it publicly and, you know, on Instagram, and I think that that is what an artist does. It's just, it looks, I think, when I hear the word art, I automatically, coming from art school, go right back to this, like, there are structured mediums that I have to, you know, utilize or be a master at in order to be considered an artist, and I dabble in some of them, but I'm not a master at any of them, and yeah, I think that the art just flows through me in maybe non-traditional ways or in literally everything.
Absolutely.
Perhaps.
Yeah, that's beautiful. Well put. Thank you. That was good. Oh, man. I try and drink less coffee. It's still delicious.
Mm.
It's different.
It's relevant, too.
Yeah, the Colombia. I usually get the Ethiopian. I got the Colombia this time. Super tasty. Everybody knows relevant, don't they?
Oh, yeah. I hope so.
I'm going to try and get Mitch on the show. I mean, he's they're building some stuff down there now, but all the coffee, like Marty's coming on soon. Mitch, I want to get Brian from Compass.
Cool.
Get all the coffee homies through.
There's some great coffee in Vancouver.
Absolutely. Great really? North is good, too.
Yeah.
I know you guys go out there, right?
Oh, yeah.
Cool.
Yep.
Right on. Cool, cool. Tell us about Barbari, please. The first introduction I had to it, I think you brought Max some samples. Mm-hmm. And she was like, here, try these. And I was like, what the fuck is this thing? You know, it was like, that's not kief. It's like, I mean, I don't smoke reefer. Yeah, it was like rolled in flowers and it was purple. I was trying to describe it to Lisa earlier. And I don't know if I put a good handle on it. So I'm going to let you, from owner's perspective, give it the pitch.
Okay.
Or however you want to distill it down.
Herbal smoking blends. It's things like raspberry leaf, peppermint, sage, lavender. I think the product you're talking about was a hand-rolled hemp blunt. And we collaborated with a company called Sway out of Portland. They shared a studio space with us at the time. And their kind of expertise is blunts, which is like a weed cigar for people who maybe aren't familiar. And they are decadent and, you know, you take your time with them. And we wanted to do an evolution on a trend that, I don't know if it's a trend, but Instagram has picked up on it in the last few years. It's this idea of a rose petal blunt that has kind of gone viral. And they're beautiful and they taste like roses and petals wrapped on the outside. But because our expertise, Barbari's expertise, is herbs and botanicals, and their expertise was blunts, we did a collaboration where we rolled the outside in blue lotus flower
petals.
So it's like, I wish I had one with me. Mm-hmm. It looks like confetti on the outside, but it's flower petals. And the blue lotus on the outside contributes to the experience by, it's like a...
Oh, I've learned blue lotus. It's ancient Egypt, psychedelic type stuff, yeah?
Totally, mm-hmm. yeah. And yeah, they used to mull it in wine mm-hmm. for long periods of time, and it was like their party drug. The quantities that we work with, you really have to concentrate it to get that much mm-hmm. out of an experience. And so it's... At most, you get sort of a sedating effect. It chills you out mm-hmm. in a nice way. People use blue lotus in lucid dreaming practices, like drink a tea before bed and kind of create a ritual out of it. And it was a lot of fun. And
there is a party going on next door, just saying. Right on, there's a party right here, too.
Yeah, a lot of fun everywhere. And then we did another one of those with lion's tail, which is clip daga. It is native to South Africa, and its daga means cannabis. It's considered like the wild cannabis, so mm-hmm. it's not as potent as weed, but it is used in a similar way in that region of the world. It's really nice. Like, definitely, like, all of the herbs that we work with, we sort of focus in on the effect that you get when you smoke it specifically. And then think about how that pairs with weed. You know, I prefer to smoke weed over drink alcohol. Like, when I'm trying to relax or tap into, like, a different mindset, that's what I go to. I learned about myself pretty young that I'm a lightweight when it comes to, or I don't know if lightweight equates to weed consumption mm-hmm. in the same way as it does with alcohol, but I learned that I don't need very much mm-hmm. to get a like pretty massive impact.
Yes.
And so then I turned to botanical blends because I knew people smoked spliffs, you know, tobacco and weed. Part of that is to, like, lean into the inebriation effect of it, but part of it is also to be consuming less weed at a time, cannabis, and to sort of save your stash. And tobacco just wasn't, it didn't hit for me in the way it didn't do what I needed it to do. So I started looking into different smokable herbs. And this was in college when I was going to art school. So I was already in the mindset of, how can I make this thing into something that into my vision? And I think I approached it with that kind of artistic spirit of, I like to smoke weed. I also see that there is a need here in my life to not smoke as much. And yet. I like the ritual of it, and I don't want to give that up. So what else is out there for me so that I can have this thing in the exact way that I need it? So, long story short, did a bunch of research about different smokable herbs, the different traditions of smoking herbs in, you know, different cultures and periods of time, and found the ones that I liked the most and just started creating my own smoking blends. For years, that was how I consumed cannabis, was along with other herbs. And, you know, through my own trial and error, I found what effect kind of profiles I was drawn to and what time of day or, you know, activities I was trying to do and how I would sort of tailor what I was smoking. It became sort of scientific in a way.
Absolutely, yeah.
And around that time that I was really sort of hitting my stride, I had like a light bulb moment. There was something that just turned on in my brain, and it was like a knowingness, like a falling in love, maybe. Oh, I don't know how to describe it, but it all of a sudden I knew. I was like, oh, this is going to be a thing I'm going to return to in my future, and it's going to take my life in a whole. I just knew it was going to change the way I was sort of existing in the world somehow. And then I left it at that, and I just kept doing my life, you know, graduated from college, started my career in the advertising space in Portland, and just stayed in that creative mindset, learned who I was in all of that. And then in 2016, I was experiencing some career burnout, not feeling inspired in the same way that I hoped to be as I dove into the kind of creative career work that I was doing. And all the while still, you know, turning to weed and herbal smoking blends almost daily. And then cannabis became recreationally legal in Oregon, and the light bulb moment came back for me. I was like, I'm not really loving what I'm doing here. How can I, like, change my life and make it into what I need it to be? And all of a sudden, I was flooded with this, like, creative inspiration and flow, and I just started the Google Doc and started outlining what it was that I wanted to create and how, you know, what was the intention for this product that I felt like needed to be in the market. And it kind of just had a life of its own in a way. I think in a way that, like, when you get into the creative flow, it just comes out of you and it just builds itself in a way. And that's what I experienced in the early days with Barbari. And then was talking about it with a good friend from college who was visiting in New York, and she was really energized by what I was talking about, and she had another kind of level of momentum and energy that she was willing to bring to the project. So it was validating to see somebody else see what I was seeing.
Absolutely.
And the two of us sort of like snowballed off of each other, and it just kept rolling and rolling until 3 years later we got to a place where we were accepted to an accelerator program, and that was the moment where we were like, okay, we're quitting our jobs and we're diving into this.
Nice.
Early 2019. And from then on, I've been self-employed and sort of all in on this company, building it, and learning how to raise a child, like the company being the child first and foremost before my
kids,
actual human child came along.
Absolutely, yeah.
But it's funny how many parallels there are in human children and creative children.
They need all the attention all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're responsible for them. That's beautiful. Yeah, tremendous amount of work, and you're doing it. You did it, and you're doing it, and you will continue to do it. What's your partner's name?
Meryl.
Meryl?
Yeah.
Meryl. Cool. And she's in New York?
She is, yeah. Uh-huh. She kind of bounced back and forth. Was born and raised in Portland, and came back to Portland to work on the project with me after she was in New York for a matter of years.
I think I follow her on Instagram.
Maybe.
Maristotle?
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, that person's super cool. Now yeah. I can put the two together.
Yep.
Nice to meet you. Virtually, whatever it is. Cool. Nice. Right on. Cool.
Yeah.
Right on. And it's a national company now, right?
Yeah. Yeah. We are in dispensaries all over the U.S. We're in non-dispensary, like, lifestyle boutiques, smoke shops. Urban Outfitters Online is carrying us.
Wow.
Yeah.
Big deal.
It's getting there. Yeah.
I can dig it. Super cool. Yeah, I remember it distinctly. I remember the packaging. I remember being beautiful. And, you know, I don't smoke pretty much anything anymore. Mac made me a spliff with some of the tobacco that she had grown for the ice cream. But, you know, when she gave me that, I remember sitting down, took a couple puffs, and I was like, man, I haven't sat down and smoked anything in a very long time. And a word you mentioned, I wrote it down, ritual. Like, the ritual of just, you know, I used to smoke Black and Milds for about 10 years, but, like, going out and, like, sitting down and taking a smoke break, a literal smoke, whether it be reefer or whatever, but the ritual of, like,
yeah.
And I could probably be deep breathing oxygen, but I'm doing this smoke. But it was quite relaxing, I remember.
I mean, and you've, you know, worked in kitchens for mm-hmm. however many years, mm-hmm. but I think that that's, like, kind of part of the culture, too. Like, stepping out mm-hmm. for a minute and, you know, people who smoke often get a smoke break.
Yeah.
And if you don't smoke, you don't.
Exactly. So you become a smoker.
So you become yeah. a smoker, exactly. So you can go step outside. So. Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
But you don't have to smoke, you know, cigarettes. There's other... There are options.
Options, exactly, yeah. Yeah, when I smoked Black and Milds, you know, when I learned how to do it in Trenton, New Jersey, it was a cultural thing. So the process of taking all the tobacco out and mm-hmm. rigging it back. I mean, we didn't fill it with anything else. You just repack it. But it's called regulating or champing a mild. That's how we smoked them back in the day. But it was a ritual type thing. You know, sit down and go through this whole process. So if you got 5 minutes for a smoke break, I wasn't doing that. You
yeah,
know, because
totally.
It would take me my whole time.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah, that was the thing. I remember a lot of people was like, hey, you didn't smoke when you started. I was like, well, I didn't get a break then.
Yeah.
So just go hang out with the smokers in the back.
Yeah.
By the used oil vessel.
Yeah. Dumpster.
Yeah, dumpster. Yeah. Yeah. Kind of cool, kind of gross bonding moment.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, hey, we're getting ready to go to battle. Let's go do it. Cool. Right on. Have you worked in the food service industry?
At like a small cafe summer job.
Absolutely.
I guess this doesn't count, but I drove a golf cart, beverage cart for a couple summers too. So, you know,
beer
a little
cart?
Bit of alcohol, a little bit of food, a little bit of coffee at one point.
That beer cart, that's like an oasis sometimes out there. It's like I'm starving to death, or you get a hot dog and a beer.
Yeah.
Or something.
We didn't have food, but yeah. Totally. It is fun to be the person who brings the party, you know,
nice,
to the golfers.
That's pretty cool. I can dig it. Right on. Yeah. That sounds like a tremendous amount of work, and you're doing it with the family and all the other things, too. Good deal.
Small steps, you know.
Yeah. I mean, 1% every day or a percent of a percent every day is still progress.
Totally.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, I really believe that.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big thing I tell people is, like, take a tiny step, take one small move towards the goal, and then look back in a week and see what you accomplished, and then look back in a month and see what you accomplished. And if you get into that habit of just, like, small efforts, they snowball, they build momentum, and then next thing you know, you've built a national company.
Exactly. Woo-hoo. It's beautiful. Yeah, the discipline to establish the habit. That's the hardest part. Getting up and do the work every day. And then, you know, setting the goal might be the first part, but getting the discipline to get to that. But you mentioned it, being able to step back after a week or a month. That's on the board upstairs right now, too. You know, Mac has come up a little over a year on her business. And I was like, you know, I ended up writing it down for many other reasons, but that was one, too. But you ever just take a step back and look how far you've come?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a big deal.
It's
just
so
everybody
important.
In life, too, but
as
a business, too.
Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, gosh, for us in the early days, it looked like sending an email to somebody and making it known that we were building a brand.
Mm-hmm.
And that felt like such a monumental move because you're acknowledging this thing that you're manifesting and also putting it into the world and hoping that people think it's legit and worth their time
mm-hmm.
and take you seriously. And so, you know, one email a week became, let's have a meeting every week. Let's like talk about our ideas every week. And then that became, okay, we have action items. Like, you're going to register the business. I'm going to go make a email template to send out to whoever. And as you do that, you know, it becomes part of the routine pretty naturally, mm-hmm. I think. You know, you don't have to like come up with a business and say, I have to execute this well in 6 weeks or it's a failure, because that's just unreasonable. And honestly, I don't think anyone can do that, really. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't think that the first iteration of any idea is the like one that you want to put all of your money into or all your eggs into. I think business is dynamic, creativity is dynamic, the concept of creating anything has to be an evolving process, because it, I think you always have to like put something out there and see how you react to it or other people react to it or it reacts to its environment, mm-hmm. and then
it reacts to its environment. That's pretty cool.
Like, yeah, and then, you know, you nurture it, mm-hmm. to help it thrive, and you make small changes here and there, mm-hmm. and then sometimes you make bigger changes because you feel confident that that's what you need to do, and then again, like, next thing you know, you turn around and you're like, whoa, look at this thing that I made. It came together not by big brush strokes, mm-hmm. but by tiny little details, yeah. that I added or took away.
Exactly. Gestures. That's beautiful.
Gestures, yeah.
Do you have employees?
We did. We, kind of pre-pandemic, we had production staff.
When did you start in 2019?
In 2019, what was your question?
I asked if you had employees, and I said, when did you start in 2019?
In 2019, our accelerator program started, mm-hmm. in January.
Okay.
But we were working full-time jobs and building this before, okay. that. Mm-hmm. It was just sort of the turning point. Mm-hmm. We did have employees. We did all of our own production in Portland, mm-hmm. And shipping fulfillment. And then actually at the start of this year, we moved to a third-party manufacturer, really? And fulfillment partner, which has been really nice for Merrill and I as business partners. And because of the scale of our business, we realized that it was not the right move for us to try and hold down a physical location, mm-hmm. and be producing all of this product and hold the liability of that. So we luckily found a really awesome, trustworthy partner in Utah and offloaded all of that to them.
Excellent.
So we'll see how it goes, but so far so good. It's definitely changed the way we're structuring our workflow, mm-hmm. And it has enabled Merrill to get back to New York, and you know, just the vision that we kind of had for our own lifestyle as we started building this company has always been this idea of us being able to work wherever we want to work and create this brand that we're putting into the world and speak to people through it, but it doesn't work for us to have that 9-to-5 lifestyle. It doesn't work for us to be like in an office, you know, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. So that was a part of the business that felt really stifling to us at first, because we felt like we had to conform to that. And now that we've made this move, it's enabled us to like rewrite that script a little bit, the structure of our work day. And I think it's been not just obviously liberating in the sense physically of like removing us from a physical location and allowing us to sort of exist where we want, but yeah, it's enabled us to get closer to the vision of our lifestyle that we've been trying to pursue through this whole thing.
Beautiful. The reason I asked when you started in 2019, I mean, I understood you were working up, mm-hmm. towards it, but you know, you guys made it through the pandy-wandy, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
What was that like as a pretty much brand new company coming into it?
I don't know. I think we were maybe blindly optimistic through the whole thing. The pandemic was such a weird thing because, at least from my perspective, it felt like, oh, this thing's going to be over in a month or two. Mm-hmm. You know, at the beginning, like, it felt like a snow day in a way, like, mm-hmm. where school's closed, like, fun, we're all, like, camping out, not fun, but, like, the novelty of that shift in lifestyle so drastically was beneficial, I think, in the sense that it made everybody, or it gave people the opportunity to not be a drone bee in the cycle of mm-hmm. capitalism. It forced everyone to, like, quiet down, huddle down, and just disrupted everything. And so there was some of that that was inspiring because it actually gave us more space to be creative and to rethink, like, all right, here's a huge disruption. How are we going to ride this wave? Like, what are we going to do as a business? And how are we going to produce our product? Like, you know, how does this change our way of operating? And the cannabis industry, we're, you know, cannabis adjacent, so we often ride the wave of what's going on there, and it did really well during the pandemic, thankfully. And so that kept us afloat. It definitely put wind in our sails. And you know, we're small, we're like a pretty small operation, so it's easy to be pretty limber and flexible as a business. And when I look at, you know, bigger companies, even within the cannabis industry, some of them really struggled through that because they're so rigid in their operations, and that obviously serves its own purpose when you're at that scale. Mm-hmm. But that was a huge advantage to us during the pandemic, is like, okay, we have two people that we need to be in our production space making product. Cool. We can easily do that safely during the pandemic. We've got enough space. You know, if we had to bring it down to one person, we'd probably get by. Yeah, we just were able to do the Matrix game or whatever, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, right on. That's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Even on this block, or, you know, Main Street and whatnot, there's been a couple businesses. I know Birdhouse Books, Marty's Terrain Coffee, you know, they all hit it right in the fucking pandemic.
Yeah.
There, and it was like, and they made it through, you know. That says, I won't say a lot about the community. Yeah, well, I could say that, yeah.
Yeah.
The community really supported the local business and whatnot.
Yeah, and it's, I mean, cool. Yeah, food service, you got mm-hmm. you made it through.
We did, yeah. It was, I was just looking at the books during that time frame recently. It wasn't pretty, but we made it,
yeah.
You know. And sometimes, you know, that's the biggest thing, just making it through. It doesn't have to be pretty.
Totally.
And here we are now doing the damn thing. Yeah, it was an interesting time, and you made it, so congratulations.
Likewise.
So cool. Do you consider yourself you're a mother and have a business and all the things, pardon me. Do you consider yourself busy?
That's an interesting question. Yeah, totally. Wow, I don't even know how to answer that question, because I'm sitting here, like, analyzing, how do I define busy?
Mm-hmm.
if we're talking physically, like, doing shit all day, mm-hmm. yeah, totally. I'm, you know, my husband and I both work from home. I run my business out of my home, at least my operations out of my home. Most of the time, the toddler is there with me, probably at my side doing her thing. So like a typical work day these days for me looks like waking up and doing kids stuff, sending some emails, checking the Instagram, making sure I'm like paying attention to my task list, and then it's get the most important things done today, and whatever I can get done, great. And I don't have expectations, or I'm not pressuring myself to be delivering at the same pace that I would if I were working, you know, a corporate job or even just like a agency job. And that feels really nice because I feel super fulfilled in my productivity every day. But I just don't feel the pressure of having to deliver unless it's what I can and want to do.
freedom.
If it's, yeah, it's like a liberation from, yeah, liberation, I think, yeah, that structure and the burnout that I've experienced past. It's like I physically don't think that I can go back to that state of mind or that pressure level.
Absolutely.
I learned the hard way, I mean, through experiencing the kind of mental shift that comes from, and disappointment, you know, all the, mm-hmm, I think all the feelings that you can feel when you're burnt out, especially in a career where it felt like it was your dream career or your dream, your passion, and then realizing that it's not not serving you the way you hoped it would. It can be devastating.
How long did you exist in the corporate world?
It wasn't corporate, but it was like, yeah,
in your chosen field,
agency,
yeah, brand.
Mm-hmm. Kind of brand work for like 6 years.
Oh, so you're a professional.
Yeah, I was in it for a while.
Yeah, you hit that stage where I'm like doing this anymore. It's so easy. I could just do it.
The thing is, I totally loved it, yeah. And would probably go back if, mm-hmm, I could do it my own way. Mm-hmm. But especially, like, I think part of the cocktail there for me was that it was, you know, my first couple of jobs right out of college, I was like, had all of this energy. I was, mm-hmm, like, I'm ready to prove myself. Yeah. I'm excited. Wow, look at these, you know, opportunities in front of me. I get to work with cool clients. I get to travel and, you know, fun exposure. And I put, I think, all of my creative vulnerability out, and I was like, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I'll shape myself into whatever shape of box you need me to be in order to get the experience and sort of placements on projects that I wanted. And that's a double-edged sword.
Agreed.
Because, yeah, you exhaust yourself for somebody else's vision, and you feel all of the vulnerability and everything that you need to feel in order to be creative or artistic professionally and have something meaningful come out of you that resonates with other people. I feel like you have to pull a piece of yourself out and do that for somebody else. And then if, you know, you basically have to callus over in order to, I think, to be successful at that for a long term. In the sense that you get so many layers of criticism, or not criticism, but critique, and then evolution of the ideas, so that eventually it becomes somebody else's altogether. And then you layer in, you know, the client expectations. And I think that for me, at that young kind of age in my career, I didn't understand that I needed to throttle the energy that I was putting into it, or that I needed to be careful about being too invested in the work I was doing. Now, I think that I understand how to balance that a little bit better. I think largely due to the fact that I created and put out into the world this brand and this product, and that was terrifying. Mm-hmm. And now, you know, I have a better sense of, okay, I can be vulnerable. I can put, you know, things into the world and let people react to them. And even if they don't react the way I intended it to be received, that's good and okay. Like, that's fine. And that's really valuable insight to understand how your product or your idea is the life that it has, the way it impacts other people, and the sort of energy that it possesses.
I can dig it.
I got off on a tangent there.
No, it was great.
But that, yeah, I got burnt out at the brand, mm-hmm, agency. Long story short.
When you were saying that, I was thinking, it was like, this is great advice for people, for young people getting into any kind of game in any type of field. It's like, yeah, it's okay to say no. You know?
Yeah.
You work 1,000 hours this week. Yeah, fuck it, I'm going to be great and you're going to love all this stuff. No.
Yeah.
You can say no.
And yeah, totally. Yeah. I think also as an employee, or just as the person that isn't the boss, mm-hmm, you know, you actually do have a lot of agency in that. Mm-hmm. And I think that I'm hoping, especially post-pandemic, gone are the days where everybody thinks they have to work themselves to death in, mm-hmm, order, like, to gain any kind of merit or placement or advancement in their job. Mm-hmm. I hope that that culture has changed, because that was very much in place, you know, 10 years ago. And 3 years ago, really. Mm-hmm. and it can feel like, as an employee or as like a young person starting out in really any career, that you have to almost be hazed in order to deserve your place in that machine.
Hazing is a good word for it. Yeah. Paying your dues, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And, you know, chin up. It sucks always, but everybody's done it before you, mm-hmm. and so you have to do it too. That's so toxic, and it's dangerous, and I think that it can be also a huge barrier to entry for people who don't have the same way of existing, or I'm like losing the word that I want to say, but like mental calibration, mm-hmm. that I guess you're expected to have in order to fit into that machine.
Yeah.
So fuck that.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah. You know, I've been cooking a little over 20 years now, I think, and that was, you know, Kitchen Confidential was a book by Anthony Bourdain that a lot of people read, and he spoke of, you know, certain types of hazing and whatnot. You know, cooking for over 20 years now, there was definitely some forms of that, even that I participated in some kitchens, and there was a certain rigor, like, hey, this is going to be the way that it's going to go down. You know, not physical, like he, you know, somebody, they were playing grab ass and he stabbed somebody with a meat fork. You know, I know it wasn't that level, but, you know, I definitely seen fist fights and chefs yell and throw plates and things like that. And, you know, there was a time in my career, probably even early on in this shop, where there was a certain, hey, what the fuck are you doing? You know?
Yeah.
And then it got to a point where, you know, that changed. And I'm so grateful for that. That I give everybody that comes in the shop, the agency, you know, and it's like, I'm hiring for you. I don't want you to be like, hey, you know, 42 pieces of flair. I don't want you to be this person over here. It's like, hey, if somebody disrespects you, tell them, go get the fuck out of here and go fuck yourself. You know, somebody disrespects you, it's like, hey, my boss would tell you to go fuck yourself. Here's his phone number. Call him. I'm cool with that. Say that right to him. You know? Yeah. In the end, you know, kitchens, I think, even all that hazing, just like family or locker room or team or anything like that, you know, there's a certain amount of camaraderie that comes with that. Unfortunately, it's like, hey, you made it. We were in the trenches together. And, you know, you'd go to battle for any one of those people, too. You know?
Yeah.
I'd still do that with the staff I have now. It's just a different upcoming through mm-hmm. it, you know. I bond with them. Truly, not traumatically, perhaps.
Yeah,
it's like, hey, there's a true bond. I like you as a person. We're good at what we do. We get along. I love you.
Yeah.
Somebody disrespects you, I got a fucking problem.
Yeah. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, I mean, I think that you can... Trauma bond is, I think, a good word to throw in here, because I think that you can still have the benefit of what we would call a trauma bond through experiencing trials and tribulations with somebody, mm-hmm. A really hard hike. I know you like to hike, or, you know, if it's like physical exercise, or if it's like, oh shit, our revenue is down, mm-hmm. and how are we all going to work together to make this, you know, company survive? Just coming together to problem solve or to like work through things that, you know, in those moments that are not as, easy mm-hmm. is, I think, a beautiful way to find teamwork and family, mm-hmm. you know, chosen family, whatever. And yet, it doesn't have to be forced upon you by, you know, the pull yourself up by your bootstraps sort of mentality that exists in, I don't know, capitalism, you know?
I could dig it, yeah.
I think you can have the benefit of that and also be gentler to each other.
Yeah. Perhaps all the time. Yeah. Trauma bond, I mean, I've heard that word around and I'm familiar with the concept of it. You know, looking back on it, you know, cooking for a while, it's like, you don't remember those thousands and thousands of dishes that went out excellently. It's like, remember that 1 hour of their service when we were just fucking going down hard and everything went wrong? And that's a thing that everybody remembers too.
Yeah,
you don't remember all the, you don't necessarily remember all the good times, but those bad times really stick out. But the big part about that is, hey, you made it.
We made it through.
Yeah, it's like we buckled down and we did it and we're out now and perhaps we're even better for it.
And I think there's something really beautiful about those moments right after that where everybody gets out of the like cloud and they're like, like you see each other in a different way,
absolutely,
you know, and I mean, it is a bond that comes from that, and that can last. You can ride that high for a while.
It's beautiful,
in a relationship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, trauma is neuroplasticity, just like you know, other things are. You know, healing can be neuroplasticity, and you know, doing certain mushrooms or whatnot, you could have neuroplasticity. But trauma is, you know, the changing of certain pathways and whatnot. Yeah, trauma bond. Yeah, connect to a person that way, and not necessarily that situation may have been bad, negative, whatever it was, but the outcome was good. So the, I don't know, the trauma bond itself, the label of that, that sounds kind of a pejorative, I guess. Like that's a bad thing.
Yeah.
But the thing that with the result of it was like, hey, here's a great relationship, and that's the thing that brought us through it.
I think that it can be both things.
All right.
I think. Cool. I mean, I'm not a psychiatrist, but
take that off of the list of things. We're not affiliated with Stanford University, right?
But I guess from my perspective, whatever it means to bond through trauma, that is trauma bond, and it can definitely be used or leveraged in harmful ways, certainly. But it can also happen in, to your point, productive ways, positive ways.
Yeah, overcoming stressful things. That's how we, I don't want to say necessarily get better, but that's something that forwards us as humans, you know. In the handbook for operation of our meat suits, you have to have stress and you have to overcome stress, you know.
You have to suffer a little bit or a lot.
Ooh, yeah. Some would say to live is to suffer.
Mm-hmm.
You will
mm-hmm.
experience suffering. Yeah, man. I think the, I've said this before maybe, the original translation, if it's Zen or whatever it is, to live is to have stress, but it's distilled down to live is to suffer.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I think about that sometimes, that interpretation. I think that's a Buddhist concept, right?
Mm-hmm.
The living is suffering, something to that effect. I'm glad that you brought up the actual original translation of it, because that for me is what it means. Like that's, I think, what I have come to realize is that, well, okay, life isn't suffering. We're obviously not suffering all the time, but we will suffer and experience suffering. And that is just a fundamental truth of existing. And yeah, I think, I like that insight. I think I turn to that quite often in my hard times, like, we're suffering, it's okay. That is life, says the Buddha.
Says the Buddha, right on. This too shall pass, right?
Mm-hmm.
Permanence and impermanence, nothing will last, or maybe everything will. I don't know, again, we're not affiliated with Stanford University. They probably have a paper on it or whatnot. Do you follow Buddha or anything like that? Not down the street, but like on a book or in your mind, whatever.
Yeah, in some ways.
Right on.
Yeah. I consider myself very spiritual, in a very unstructured way. And in college, actually, I studied religion and philosophy. I took, I don't know how credits work in my brain these days, but quite a few credits of different religion philosophy classes. And that was in a moment where I was born and raised Christian, and started to realize that I just didn't connect with that. It didn't, it wasn't compelling, and I saw a lot of flaws in like the structured religion of Christianity, and was super interested in religion, like generally. Like I have always been spiritual, and I think kind of mystical in my spirituality, and through my rejection of Christianity at that time, I wanted to, I had a hypothesis that all religions are basically the same thing.
That's one way to look at it, yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. they're just different interpretations of the same truth. And
do
so
the right thing. Spike Lee said it best for me. It's like, do the right thing. Yeah,
yeah, exactly. Yeah. And we all believe in some sort of a higher power to mm-hmm. some extent, whether that's quantum physics or a bearded man in the sky, mm-hmm. you know.
Here we go with the quantum physics. Oh, my goodness.
I can't speak on that, but...
Please do. The internet loves it.
No.
According to the last Instagram fucking analytics.
Oh, man.
We'll talk about that later. Right on.
That's but, cool. yeah. I took took some classes in Buddhism. I took some classes in Hinduism and Confucianism and Taoism and then Christianity, history of Christianity, and all... in like two terms all at once. I was transferring into a new school, and so it was sort of my going out party for myself. And it was not the thing I was studying wasn't working towards a philosophy degree. I just had a term where I wanted to do this, and it was, you know, obviously very enlightening, very fascinating. And I will say that, not to oversimplify it, but I think that my hypothesis was generally correct, mm-hmm. that there is, and you can even see, like, you know, zooming out of that core truth that everybody, not everybody, but every sort of major and not major religion has a level of mysticism and faith built into the structure of, I guess, the tenets of the religion. There's so many different overlapping themes and visuals or morals or stories that are told through all of these different traditions that, you know, are essentially the same. They're essentially the same story.
Mm-hmm.
So that was cool. But I definitely found that I was mostly drawn to the Buddhist and honestly, kind of generally the Eastern religions. I found a lot of value in that, the insights and the sort of ways of life that Confucianism and Taoism and Buddhism kind of practiced. It just aligned with who I know I am, and how I think I can tune into the divine, or the way in which I relate to it, I suppose. It's probably a better way of putting it.
It's how you relate to yourself, perhaps.
Yeah, definitely is, mm-hmm. yeah. So, yeah.
Beautiful. At a point you said you rejected Christianity, and then you came to this hypothesis that they're all pretty much the same thing. Would you say you like full-on rejected Christianity, or now that you see it as a part of this collective of religion in general?
I see it as part of the collective.
Okay.
In a way, I mean, I guess I don't think that I'm the person that will ever go to church every week. However, I really enjoy going to a Catholic service every once in a while because of the architecture and the, honestly, it feels like a work of art, an experience of art, to go in there and to just like tap into the energy that exists in those religious spaces. I can think that that can be really powerful and profound, and obviously that is a very powerful tool, and we can see how it, you know, draws many, many people in that influence that you that come, or maybe, yeah, it, yeah, influence yeah. that comes from existing on a wavelength with an energetic wavelength with people all at once in a building, or, you know, I mean, that's how cults and things come about, right? It's like people feel tapped into a an energy wavelength, mm-hmm. and that's compelling, and they want more of that, and that is beautiful, and I like to tap into that sometimes, but I don't feel like I can always exist in that community, maybe. Mm-hmm. It feels a little too, like, powerful, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, the Catholic Church, I don't know if I've been to maybe like a funeral or two growing up, but, you know, there's a large ornate space, people wearing costumes,
yeah,
and singing,
yeah,
and swinging the thing that smells like, is that making me high? I feel some kind of way about this, and talking about these things that I know not, or maybe I do, I don't know, you know? Some,
yeah,
of it makes sense, some of it is hard to believe, and, you know, millions and billions of people follow some way, shape, or form.
Yeah. Yeah.
Interesting. Faith. People have faith.
Yeah.
Which is not necessarily a bad thing, I would say.
No, I wouldn't either. It can be used against you. I think I'm kind of skeptical. I think that's what is coming to the surface here as we talk this out, that a lot of my rejection of Christianity and, it, honestly, any kind of structured religious organization is a skepticism and a caution of being, of buying into a scripted sort of expectation of a belief system. Like, one of the triggering moments for me in high school for, you know, to realize, like, okay, something's not quite right here, is that I was at a youth group, and they were talking about, I think this was right around the time when gay marriage was being debated to federally legalize it, and there was an overwhelming, like, perspective that that was a sinful thing, and that gay marriage is a terrible idea, and we got into a pretty heated debate. I remember it was me and one other guy and probably 15 other high schoolers in there, you know, I think having a relatively thoughtful conversation. I love that we actually did dig into these issues.
Yeah.
But it was very obvious that the sort of way in which they were interpreting the Bible as a text was tailored to their worldview, and I probably was doing the same thing in a way, but what was hard for me is that we are sort of taught that this idea of God, of the Christian God, is, you know, all-knowing, never makes mistakes, all-loving, like, that there is, that everything is done with intention, and yet we can't accept that the way people are is in that vision. Mm-hmm. Like, that we're, you know, demonizing people for being themselves because it's anti-God or whatever, but yet if we believe that God is what God is, then that's hypocritical. We can't be the ones to make that judgment. Mm. People are here because that was the intention of God. People are as they are because that was the intention of God. And it just, I don't know. I mean, I just remember being angry about it, and all of a sudden I was like, you guys are, you know, I think misconstruing the sort of core values of what Christianity is. And then it had me second guess kind of everything at that time.
And you were in high school, yeah?
I was in high school, yeah.
It's a pretty early realization. That's good.
Yeah, I mean, it gave me a moment to also look at myself and ask, like, okay, do I actually believe that anything or anyone that is intelligent is hearing my prayers and doing anything about them? Like, I'm not sure that I do. I think that this is just something I was taught to do, is to pray. And I think there's a lot of power in prayer when it's done intentionally. I think it's the same idea as, you know, meditation and manifestation. But at that age, not at all. I didn't have that wherewithal as a human that I had agency in my intention and my prayer. I just felt like I was asking for things. And maybe I got it, maybe I didn't. I don't know. Oftentimes I didn't. So that skepticism stemmed from those types of youth group conversations. And then by the time college rolled around, I was even further into the skepticism and just kind of post-teenage angst, kind of, you know, learning about the world, first time living on my own, just asking why to myself about pretty much everything. But yet also knowing that I am an intuitive human being and I have a core spirituality in me that I don't quite know what it is, but there's something there, and I always sort of turn to this like magic mind. I don't know even how to describe it. Mystic mind, maybe. And yeah, and then, you know, I was able to take those religious philosophy classes, and they were really intense and really enlightening, and yeah.
A bunch of information during formative years.
Totally, yeah. After I was able to do some self-reflection.
Mm-hmm.
And during.
I could dig it. Having conversations on this show and some of my personal life, I wouldn't say I've, you know, deep dived back into it, but it's, I've been dipping my toes back into some Christianity. Mm. I wouldn't necessarily say I've poo-pooed it, you know, like you said, like your hypothesis, like they're all the same. I've kind of, not the same, but they're all have the general same message. I've kind of seen that a little bit, and I think just Christianity is so prevalent. Those are the things, yeah, that have been coming up. Oh, Ecclesiastics, you know, 2:25 or whatever it is. It's like, oh, that's, I could use that right now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to take that and be like, thank you. Yeah, I'm not super familiar with the other religions, but yeah, I think I'm okay with them.
Yeah, totally.
In general. Not necessarily a staunch follower of any right now, but, you know, walking through the general message of walking through the world as a good people, do no harm,
mm-hmm,
do the right thing, help people, you know, a mitzvah here and there. I think I just looked that up today. A mitzvah, I think the Hebrew translation, could you pull that up? Mitzvah, the word itself means commandment, but the more popular or modern thing is like a good deed.
Mm.
Like, it's like, hey, I need $100 for something, and I give you $200.
Yeah.
Like, that's a mitzvah. But I think mitzvah means command. Oh, it says commandment right there, right? Mitzvah, the literal meaning of the Hebrew word mitzvah is commandment. But the generally accepted sense is that of a good deed. The emphasis is on deeds, mm-hmm, not on positive thoughts or wishes, but on conscious acts of empathy and kindness. Yeah.
Love that.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, right? Throw some mitzvahs around.
Yeah. Yeah.
I remember working in Red Hook, Brooklyn, and somebody came into the shop, Hasidic Jews and whatnot, and a guy was having a conversation with me, and he was like, you're Jewish? I was like, aren't we all? I just kind of, I don't know if I kind of said it in jest or something. I said, aren't we all? And he went out to his car, and he got me, I forget what holiday it was around, but it was like chocolate-covered pretzels and stuff like that. And he was like, here, it's a mitzvah. And he's like, I have to do this. And I was like, he was like, you know, and I'm like, yes, thank you. I love this, you know, and I put it down. And I was like, all right, cool, man. I got some snacks, you know, and that was a mitzvah. And I don't know if it was a rote thing, just like, oh, I have to give these out so I can, that's the pebble that gets me through the gate or whatever. But,
right.
It's distinct and I remember it.
Yeah, yeah.
But he said it was a mitzvah. But yeah, empathy. I like that.
I do too.
Cool, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. What was that question? You're a busy person. That was a lot.
Oh,
that
wow.
Was good. Yeah,
no. We went far.
No,
from
it was
that.
Good. No, it was beautiful. It was a great conversation right there.
Gosh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. I'm busy.
Yeah, I can dig
but
it.
But I like it that way.
Yeah.
I definitely thrive from, I'm like a completionist, so I thrive from having projects and completing them. Mm. And even
a task master.
Tiny.
Yeah.
Kind of.
You like checking boxes? I did this, crossing stuff off.
Right? Oh, yeah. Yeah, cool. That's really satisfying.
Your Google Sheets,
mm-hmm,
right on.
Mm-hmm.
Look at you smiling over there, trying to hold back the smile. You're just thinking about it. Like, I love crossing shit off. Yeah, man. Yeah, I've put stuff on lists just so I can cross it. I know I've done it.
Oh, yeah.
I put it on there and to cross it right off.
Already did it, but yeah. I'm going to put it on the list so I can check that box.
Yeah, it's a little victory to get you going,
yeah,
to get that snowball going.
Yep.
That's beautiful. Cool, cool. Being a busy person with all these things that you do, what do you do for rest and recovery?
Mm.
If at all, or what does that look like to you?
It depends on the season, but this season, this spring, summer season. It looks like me being out in my garden, playing in the dirt, like zooming into the tiny particles, the bugs and the pollen, and just like observing while being productive, weeding or planting new plants or, I don't know, growing vegetables. I like to smoke a little weed, listen to noise-canceling headphones, binaural audio, and just like be
binaural audio?
Yeah, binaural.
Everybody's shaking their head over here. Okay. Help.
Do you know what it is? Yeah, I figured he would.
Okay.
It's, he's going to define it here for us.
Look at that. Is that what your headset looks like?
No, that's not for robots at all. Only. I just have, you know, the classic noise-canceling headphones.
Binaural sound is stereo audio that is recorded through a dual microphone setup.
Having two ears is what it literally means. So what you experience when you listen to it is like sounds that are coming from this side, sounds that are coming from this side, not tied together.
Oh.
So it's almost like you hear the space that the music is being made in. Mm. And some there's like different
like fade stereo waves recording and shit like that when you're playing like Led Zeppelin in your car and stuff's coming out of different speakers
that. Yeah, in a way. Yeah, but I think that it's I don't actually know exactly, but I would imagine that with technology that kind of effect has evolved and like there's these like meditative playlists that are like binaural theta wave like ambient sounds and music that like it totally gets me into a flow state. It like gets me right there.
And you do that while you're gardening?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Or honestly, if I just need to like de-stimulate a little bit, mm-hmm. and like sometimes I'll just go into a quiet room if I have that luxury, but oftentimes I don't. So I'll kind of go into the noise canceling headphones world, and it just really like shuts everything out. And then putting on quietly in those this like binaural audio, it's like. It's not ASMR, but I think that it kind of gives you a similar sort of satisfactory feeling, calming.
Well, those
changes
waves
your brain waves.
Yeah,
yeah. It changes your state of being a bit, and so that's my like cheat code. That's where I like if I need quick peace, I go straight for that move.
Quick peace.
But just existing outside, I think, is where I tend to flock to when I need to recenter myself, whether that's at the river or, I don't know, we don't go on hikes as much as I want to, but that would be, you know, one of the things I would turn to.
Right on. The outside stuff, yeah. Yeah, that's been a, not necessarily a common answer, but, you know, people getting outside and doing other things, but gardening, people doing that. You know, for me, looking on that from my perspective, that's also work. You know,
yeah.
It's like, oh, I do all this busy work, and to rest or recover, I go do this other kind of work.
Yeah.
So you don't, do you see that as work, working in the garden?
Sometimes.
Or toiling in the garden?
It's, in a way, I mean, I guess, like, digging up earth is hard work. It's like, you know, physically taxing, or being hunched over. Like there's things that in, you know, working outside in the garden or in the yard can be physical work for mm-hmm. sure. And then I don't think that the task of gardening and weeding is work because I often go out without any ambitions to like get anything done. It's just being out there and plucking things from the soil is a really satisfying act for me. So yeah, I guess I just don't define it as work in my brain. Mm-hmm.
Do you define it as play, or would you define it as play?
No, I don't think so.
Right.
I don't think I would. I guess.
It's enjoyable?
Yeah, it's totally enjoyable.
Okay.
And sometimes it's not enjoyable, but I think the end conclusion, like, after, let's see, how do I put this? This is like,
this plague, I don't want to say plagues me, this is, you know, I search for rest and recovery in my world, and it's it's not necessarily out of my grasp, but I like to ask people, like, how do you do it? Come here, yeah. Try that. But yeah, like seeing how you define it now too.
Yeah. I mean, if you think this is work, then don't do this. But mm-hmm. I don't know. I guess like kind of going back to the idea of completionism, like I enjoy being able to say, like, look, I spent 3 hours on 6 square feet of earth and it looked really messy and weedy, and now it looks not messy and, you know, it's clean, it's tidy, or I've planted things, it has evolved and is hard work sometimes to get to that point, mm-hmm. but the process of it I just kind of get lost in, and I also don't have expectations that it's going to get completed. I sort of do as much as I feel like I want to do, and then I stop. And I think my husband would have a very different perspective on that. Like I think it feels like work to him, but for me, I just love being out in nature and like getting dirt under my nails, mm-hmm. and like smelling the soil. And sometimes I'll get really distracted by a slug that is working its way around, and I'll sit and observe it for a while and just kind of like let it do its thing and see how it's interacting with the terrain of my garden bed. Or I just kind of like to zoom into the details, and then my mind wanders and I sort of am enjoying just being in that moment.
A childlike wonder, perhaps.
I guess, yeah. But yeah. I mean, I experienced that when I was painting my house today, even. Mm-hmm. Just like being out there. Sorry.
You're good? Yeah, no worries.
Getting something done. It's not, I don't have to, like, there's no pressure on it. I can just move the paint roller, watch the paint cover the wall, and when I'm ready to be done, I'm done.
Beautiful.
Getting something done, letting my mind have unstructured float time, and
right on.
Breathing fresh air.
Could take it. I was at the PSU Farmers Market yesterday, and there was a child, maybe 2 or 3 or something like that, in a stroller, and you know, all the trees are green right now, and this kid was just looking up and like jaw open, seeming mesmerized by that. I remember this kid's coming at me, maybe 20 feet. I'm carrying all the vegetables. And I was like, what is this kid seeing? And I was like, fuck it. Put my stuff down. I was like, I did this fucking same thing. I was like, that's pretty fucking amazing.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And I took a step back and being like, the childlike perception, and just seeing maybe how that mind was working at that time and what they were taking in. It was pretty neat.
Yeah.
Getting that child perspective. It's a good place, keeping it maybe forever.
Yeah.
You know, being the child artist all the time. Innovation and imagination and all the things that kids come up with and do, and they are artists.
Do you find that you're closer to that as a dad than you were maybe before?
Yeah, because, you know, it's around all the time.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, it's not that we're not bored. It's like, well, let's create something, you know, and then there's just drawers and boxes of an absolute canon of work,
you
know, refrigerator art and things like that. There's no, it's like, well, what should I draw? It's like, whatever you want to draw. It's like, okay. Phew. You know, you saw the walls out there.
Yeah.
You know, the word poop, dragonflies, you know, monsters, all kinds of things. All the things come out, and it's like, hey, let's get it out. And it is. And then move on to the next thing.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And then being creative with their bodies and, you know, it's like, hey, can I do a pull-up, or can I go across the monkey bars, or, you know, do a cartwheel and shit like that. It's, it's been reinvigorating, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think it's in us all. You just got to tap into it, remember it a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's remember cool. It.
I yeah. Think. Remember it. Yeah. Yeah. Trying, you know, at a young age, maybe. Say, like, you got to work and pay taxes and go to college and all these things. It's like, hey, never lose this child spirit.
Easier said than done.
Yeah, true. Yeah?
Yeah.
I mean, maybe because it isn't, you know, fortified or mm-hmm. reinforced.
I think,
it's like, okay, well, you're XYZ age. You got to go to college and get a job and get a house and do the thing. And it's like, don't lose your fucking kid-like spirit, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Go on and go through the world with a childlike curiosity. Ask questions.
Mm-hmm.
Always ask why. You know? And if somebody says, because I said so, maybe ask somebody else. Because maybe they don't fucking know or can't say that they don't know. Yeah. Interesting. Pretty cool. Yeah. Give me a couple things. I wrote a couple things down. I haven't done that before. That's pretty cool. Yeah. Working on the garden. I went to a therapist type person, I guess. I don't think she's a licensed therapist, but she does sit and talk therapy amongst other things. But I would come to her with, like, you know, rest and recovery and whatnot. And I was like, you know, everything's work. Mm. And she was like, well, you could think of it more like tending. You know, you tend to the part of the garden you could reach, and that will have benefits on the rest of the garden. I was like, that's still like work. You're just changing the word, you know? That's why I wrote down toil. I got to look that word up too. Toil versus work for toiling. But cool. What else? What's your next project? You got all these things going on. Painting the house.
God. I feel like I have a million little projects started in my brain.
Oh, really?
Some level of executed in real life. Upon fairly recent reflection, realized that I like a project. I think that's how I operate. That's how I am structured or something. But yeah, I guess I'm trying to learn some new mediums, some new artistic mediums.
Not creative mediums, artistic mediums.
Yeah, well, I guess, gosh. Yeah. Both.
Came right round and up earthing, right on, yeah.
Both. I guess it depends on how I want to use them one day. But, you know, want to learn rug tufting. I want to learn ceramics. Rug tufting.
Do tell.
You know.
No, I don't. That's why I'm asking. What the fuck's rug tufting?
So, like.
Making rugs?
Making rugs.
Okay.
Yeah, but specifically.
Wait, is that a fiber art?
Ah, yeah.
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 I just learned that one.
Is that
recently.
What you do?
I fiber dabble art? In the fiber
okay.
arts
right
a
on.
Little bit.
Nice.
Fiber arts, right on.
Yeah. I got a tufting gun, and the way I'm learning, I'm sure that there's many different ways to do it, but wood frame, you have like canvas stretched mm-hmm. really tight across it, and then you basically draw mm-hmm. in the like your yarn is your crayon, basically. Mm-hmm. You just kind of draw on this thing. Or, sorry again, it's I'm right. a hand talker, apparently.
That's cool. You're from the East Coast, it's all right.
It's wait, like, no, you're not. You can cut that out, right?
Yeah, right.
But yeah, it's cool. Like, there's people have done some really intricate and like true like painting in the form of yarn on this. We're looking at a video now, but
that looks like a high capacity tufting gun. I think that one's not legal in the state of Washington
yeah,
right now.
Yeah, semi-automatic.
Wow, good talk. Thank you. That was great. Right on. Oh, this guy's doing some real stuff.
It's cool. Yeah.
Right on. And you do that?
No. Well, I wouldn't say I do it yet,
you're
but
dabbling?
I'm learning it. Yeah,
that's cool.
I,
right on.
Have a project underway. I'm just trying to understand like the mechanics and the physics of this. Big awkward thing but I've been drawing a lot more in the last year or so, like in my sketchbook. Ultimately, like, I think right now I'm in a phase where I'm trying to just learn new mediums enough that I feel comfortable expressing myself in them. And we'll just sort of see where the wind blows after that, but I don't know. When I became a mom mm-hmm. in 2021, I felt like I gained all of this creative energy, like inspiration, pure energy that I'd never experienced. It was just flowing through me constantly. And I think I'm still pretty close to that wavelength, but it's starting to wane a bit. But to honor that, I've just been, you know, trying to be less of a completionist and more of an explorer.
Beautiful. That's
know?
A great way to put it.
And just try to, like, put a poem on paper if that's what's flowing through me at that time. Or if I got a marker and a paper nearby, like, sketch something out. Just, like, start letting it out. Just expressing it. See how it evolves and what can come of it, and also kind of learn what my maybe artistic perspective is, because I don't think I've I don't think I know that yet. So that's kind of my like spiritual project.
Super cool. Yeah. I dig that. That's a it's sometimes a tough thing for people to do, is start new things, especially at, you know, not a child's age or a younger age, because, you know, there's that white belt stage where you're going to fail a lot, or it's not going to be real good, or it's not going to be what's up here doesn't translate to, you know, the tufting gun or the pen, or it's a fraction of it comes out, but getting it out in some way, shape, or form, and then distilling it down, it's a big deal.
Yeah,
I can dig that. That's admirable that you're trying the things.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if I have a choice right now. I think that I just like have to let it out. I feel like it's bursting out of me.
Beautiful.
Which is such a weird, it's a weird state that I feel like I'm in. A good weird.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I just have never felt this creative energy ever before. I've always been creative, but it's like, I think it's at a different level.
Finding different ways out.
Yeah, it needs to be expressed. Maybe I've just been holding it in. Like, maybe I've been too afraid to let it out.
Oh, okay.
That's a realization that I had 10 seconds ago.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The fear of expression.
It might be, yeah.
Do you think that if you create something and put it here and everybody's like, I don't like that? Is that what you're afraid of? Criticism?
At some point, definitely was. I think I've had to get over that a little bit in the last 3-4 years. But part of it probably is that I feel afraid of not completing something, or the pressure of needing it to be complete and whole, which is obviously, I've found a way around that when it comes to my career work. We started this conversation, I was like, you don't have to complete something right away, but I'm like, now that we're talking about it, I think that definitely holds me back with my artistic practice or my personal creative endeavors. I guess like part of it, I think, is also a frustration of not knowing a medium very well. Like in art school, I studied photography, and I am really good at like sort of the tool set around photography, whether that's editing or like working the camera. I can do that, and I know I can do that, but it's that as a medium is not really compelling to me in the same way as that it was when I was studying it. I don't feel like I can be as unstructured as I want to, I think, in photography, or at least the way that my like creative energy wants to come out of me now. And I wish, in hindsight, I wish I would have spent my time in art school learning more of those other mediums when I had the proximity to the tools and the experts. And I just didn't get enough of that. And so now that I think that I'm bursting at the seams with creative energy, I am like, fuck it, just get a pen or get your sketchbook and a pencil or whatever it is that you feel like you need to just release that idea or vision that's coming out of you right now, whatever it is, however it is, just do it and then let that be it. And if you come back to it another time, cool. And maybe through that process, I will, and if I have the sort of access to my tufting, you know, gun or my sketchbook or my garden, whatever it is that I'm expressing through on whims, eventually I think that I will become a master or I will become more competent in that medium, and it will enable me to say what I want to say in a very precise way. However it comes out within that structure.
Beautiful. What is it you want to say?
Through art? Or, like, through creativity? Is that...
Yes.
I'm still figuring that out. Mm. I think that... I think that a lot of it is an abstraction of my, like, feelings, really. I mean, I think that's what all art is in a way. But, like, right now, it's, I think that I want to say things, or not, I don't think I want to say anything, actually. I think I just want to, like, emote in a visual way. Mm-hmm. And then use that almost as, like, a therapeutic tool for letting my shit out.
Yeah.
And it might be gibberish, probably would be gibberish to anybody else that saw it, but that's okay. I think that it doesn't really matter to me right now. I just am in a phase of letting things out and getting comfortable doing that first and foremost. Yeah. And I'm sure that what I want to say will evolve over time.
Beautiful. Keep getting it out, or don't. I'm not
in
charge.
Yeah, totally.
I mean,
I need to.
Love Supreme album by John Coltrane. Many people listen to that and like, that's gibberish. And some people sit there and like, that fucking just changed my life. So, yeah, get your message out there.
Yeah.
You know, it's for you, but it could touch some other people too.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Right on. This was good.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to wrap it up with?
Oh, man. No. What do people usually say? Are we like plugging the things? I don't have anything
to
plug.
Yeah, definitely plug them. Yeah, give it, you know, your Instagrams and all that stuff for the business, or check them out where you can buy them at all the things.
Barbaryshop.com. Mm-hmm. I don't have much to say. Just, you know.
Not just like 2 hours worth. It was good. How much
just,
to say.
Just, you know, love your neighbor. Be good to people.
Absolutely.
Listen to people.
Listen.
Yeah.
Have empathy, perhaps?
Yeah, totally. Have conversations.
Conversations.
Yeah.
Hmm. What a cool concept. Record them or don't.
Yeah.
You know?
Just put them out there or don't.
Yeah. You know, we talked about it before. If you ever get the, or when you get your podcast situation squared away, I mean, we have space, so.
Totally. I'll definitely take you up on that.
Cool.
When I'm ready, when I have it.
Cool. I got your number and you got mine.
Yep.
Cool. Thanks, Mallory.
Thank you. What to see? It's what you get. It's what you get. What you see. What you see. It's what you get. It's what you get. I said, what you see. It's what you get.